And they are very specific to the brands. Just for the record, I want this. The slide is only for education purposes, just in case my mom views this video later on. Coming to the latest type that we have is the digital typography, right? That we are all interested in, that we all work day in, day out. This is a magazine which beautifully uses type. If you see, there's hardly any visual design as a graphic elements as visual design are hardly there, right? They're just using grids, they're just using type from, you know, bold, regular, and a good heading here, then the category and things like that. So this is something that we're all very interested in, work day in, day out, digital typography. And then there is obviously the artist typography. This is a screenshot from Dribbble. Have you guys heard of Dribbble? Yeah, so if you just go Google Dribbble, I think you'll find typography on Google, you'll find lots of artistic manifestations of types in different forms and places. A very great example has always been the I love NY example, right? Have you guys seen it? Sorry, I didn't put it in, but I thought I just remembered it. So that was very iconic. I mean, it didn't have any symbols or the high rise New York buildings or anything like that, but it just had I, heart, and NY. You know, it was like symbolic. It's gone crazy. So what is my karma as a type? My karma is to make design great. You know, what is a type apart, I mean, in this context? And how does it do it? It communicates, bottom line, first thing. This is a simple card I designed for a couple of my friends' engagement 2 days back. If you notice, there's no design or there's no visual graphic design actually involved, but a very, very type-based design, which clearly says, you know, if you read it at first instance, just say it, I think the contrast was very low. She said yes, he said no, right? But if you read further down, she and her parents said yes. He said no to all other girls, right? So it's a very creative play of words, a creative play of the sizes, creative play of the colors. You know, the first thing that you would notice is she and yes. The first thing that you would notice there is he and no, right? And then you go deeper and read. So that's how you engage with excite using type. And that's what it does. The first thing that a type does in a design is communicate. Point blank, you know, nothing else. What does it do after that? Or what can it do after that? It emotes. There is an emotion involved, right? Every type has an emotion. Every kind of type that you use or the way you use it gives some sort of emotion or a feeling out of it. So, take this example of Amazing Lab website, right? The bulb is made up of all different kinds of typefaces. The heading is big, bold, making your web work, and it is connected to a bulb. So it's a very friendly, very creative, very informal kind of emotion that I get out of this particular site. And if you really look at it, again, as I said, there's no great graphic design involved, right? It's actually type. If you remove all the graphic involved and still have just the type, you will still get the same feeling. Obviously, the other small visual elements add on to that, but on a large overall note, they have used type so very well, right? I mean, just to, reflect their particular brand and the kind of work they do. They call themselves also Amazing, right? Amazing kind of goes with their name. So, the second thing that the type does to design is it gives out emotion, it adds emotion to your design. The third very important thing that it does, it provides structure. All your applications, all your web, mobile, iPad, all the stuff, right? It has content, largely, except for a few games or enterprise charting applications. You have huge content, text content. Now, the New York Times here, I just removed the ad there. I wanted to remove the other ads, and even there are small, thin lines. Luckily, because of the contrast, you can't see them. Without even those lines, you see how well the entire page is structured. And this completely done using type, right? How they have placed the paragraph, the links, left justification, the heading consistently across the entire site, the color difference if you want to quickly get if the market is up, down, things like that. Nice big bold top header.
right there.
So your tiles match your UV structure in your design. Don't just randomly place it in there. It is part of the grid, it's part of the entire design there. Next.
Type says, I have feelings.
No, really. They do have feelings. So what does it say?
So this type says,
I feel strong. If you look at the fonts, right? If you look at the type, Museo Flexo, Intro Flexo is what I'm using in the presentation. They all feel strong. They're all sans serif fonts. They're all very clear, very readable, very straight to the point. So they have a feeling. So usually used for headings, usually used for big bold statements. Some fonts say, I feel informal. And these are the kind of fonts that will say, I feel informal. You know, cursive, handwritten fonts, curves. So it's very easy to identify that. Don't miss that out. And align that, use that to your product or to your design specification. Some fonts say, I feel classy. So there's a difference, right, between classy and being informal. Some fonts will also say, I feel military. So it's very easy, you can identify. You can identify what the font feels. And that's exactly what you need to use in your design. What exactly are you trying to do with your design? What exactly are you trying to do with your application? What exactly are you trying to do with your mobile app? And use those sort of things, maybe in your logo, maybe at different posters, I don't know, wherever you use design, right? The next thing that the font says is you don't like, you can't just put some font and say, you know, this is the kind of site we are, or this is the kind of design I want to communicate. Some of the other things are, more detailed the font is, the poorer it renders on low resolution screens. The more details it has, the it will render really bad and goes, you know, 10px, 9px, you really can't make it. So that's like a very fundamental rule you need to understand when you're using typography. Don't worry, I'll share the slide, so you need not write down on this one. Just sit back and ask me questions if you have any, maybe not a problem. So couple of common choices for headings have always been Georgia, Irish, and Helvetica. Obviously because they're being supported across the web by default without having to use WebKit or without having to use font founders, things like that. And common choices for body copy have always been Georgia, Arial, Vardana, and Lucida. This is very fundamental. Don't go ahead and use Times New Roman for a body font. It's very basic. You don't have to be a designer. So it's just observations, right? Any font, I mean, if you've seen in the bottom copyright or this, you need a very tiny font, use Vardana. It's a very, very clear font at low resolution, a very low pixel density when you really want to use a very low type size. Obviously, if you use Georgia at 8 or 9 pixel, won't be very clear. But Georgia is brilliant when it's used as a heading. I'll show you some example later on. Obviously, how we got those things, I mean, there's a research out there saying what is the average heading font size. It lies between 18 to 29 pixel. So done some study, you can just Google up. Same case for body font. The type size ranges between 12 to 14 pixel. That is what is easily readable, presentable, accepted font. Obviously there are exceptions, but if you want to go by thumb rule and not very much, use those standard things. This is a site that we did recently. Sorry about the clarity, I think the resolution has gone a little haywire. But this is the heading that we have used, this is Georgia. The font that we have used is Vardana. Yeah. I mean, it depends on the device, right? I mean, this pros and cons. So 16 pixel font on which particular typeface? That's also important, right?
Right.
So, if, for example, if I use 16 pixel for Georgia, I would be okay personally. But if you're going to use 16 pixel for, say, Vardana or Tama, I would be like, it's too much. That's my personal take because of the kind of the space that it occupies and the readability quotient of it. I think the point there is good if you want to be responsive design and you want to be on tablets and things like that. Because there you want to stand out and the content is, I mean, you have very little to do in terms of visual design. So I think 16 pixel depends on the typeface, it's very subjective. But yeah, as I said, if it's Georgia or something, I would not mind. But if it's something like Vardana, 13, 14 is the max I would do. Like in this case, we have used 13 at some places, 12 at some places, and cleverly kept it like, you know, there is a balance. So in the next slide, I mean, I've just shown few. There's 12, there's 18, there's 25, there's 10. If you look at this, it'll be different. But the entire design again is done basically on typography, entirely done on the different weights, the different styles of typography. Yeah.
Just find the copies.
Yeah. So one of the things, this is a conscious decision. Here we needed to maintain the grid layout because there is an image on the right side. And if it was left, like if you see, it's not fully justified. If it was fully justified, even the last line would have entered here. Here, yes. I mean, on the screen, try it on your web browser where the actual site is and let me know. From our feedback, I think, I mean, we've done with our client and launched the site, a lot of people found this better. But yeah, I mean, a lot of times you have to make choices between do you really justify or you keep it left justified. In this case, if you look at it on the web, it's actually pretty readable. Also because the number of words used in the single line are not beyond 5 and 6. If it's a very, really long line, then it's a problem because you can't really read so much and you have to split it in columns. That's something that a lot of people miss out. They just, you know, slap. I mean, they make great typography, something like this, but it's across the page. It's very difficult to read, very difficult to follow. Yeah. Hyphenation is something that you should do.
Pardon
me?
Soft,
yeah, I mean, you can use CSS techniques to just hyphenate. I think there is an example later on, yeah. So then you fall back on. Stick to just that. At most have just 3 font families. Don't use like, you know, something like in the next screen, right? You're like really nuts. You're like 5 different font foundries used and it makes just no sense, right? So it's a very basic rule. I'm sure designers already know it, developers may already follow it, but use it as a thumb rule, not more than 2 or at most 3. There's something that I want to share. There's usually a pattern header font size, line length and stuff like that. These are the sum numbers. So usually the header font size is almost twice the body size.
That's the vertical
reader.
Pardon
me?
That's the vertical reader.
For which one?
The
previous slide?
I think what you define is
for
the vertical reader.
Okay, the ratios
you are
telling, right?
The pattern.
These patterns, right? Sorry, I didn't know the word. Thanks for that. vertical leader.
Vertical.
Okay. So line height, body copy font size, about 1.48 is the ratio. Line length, line height is 27.8, so that's kind of huge. Space between paragraphs and line height is 0.754. You can use the simple math, may not be accurate, but just a small, simple thumb rule for you can use it in your day-to-day type, when you're doing especially content-oriented sites. Something that type can do is we can sexify anything. A very good simple example from CareTrip I'm going to show. This is from my trips page that CareTrip has. If you notice, there's hardly any visual design, again as I say. Notice the number of fonts, the way they are presented, the size, the color. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And all these are different. In terms of treatment. The same typefaces, but the way they have been treated, right? In terms of size, caps, weight, simple things like this, you can make the entire design, right? You don't really need to have I'm not an illustration guy, right? So I don't have to be even with that limitation, I can do a page like this, which is very neat, usable. And all it needs is size, the kind of type you need to use, the colors that you can use. And the alignment and the arrangement, right, for a calendar kind of a thing. You just put July on top, 7 and Saturdays below it. So it's the treatment to the type that you do really brings out the design. So that's very, very, very encouraging, because you can do so much more with it without just limiting yourself only to paragraphs and headings. And interestingly, they've used different ways of showing the design, using the font. This is like 10, 17, 9 in pixel. This is in percentage and that is in EM. Again, there are pros and cons of each of these things. There's a debate between using pixel or EM, EM scales, or scales up or scales down based on your design. Pixels is fixed, right? So if you scale down your design or reduce your browser, this one is like probably not scale down to thing. So there's a debate, but largely designers use all three, even percentages. So the font says we hate who don't treat us well. Another example of it is this messy page. Again, one of the fundamental things, never use bold, never use strong for body. You can't just read, it's not readable. It's a very basic human thing. Again, alignment here, you have a grid, have a structure. It says, we are now social, like you all. We have friends like Ufon, Google Fonts, Typesetter, so on and so forth. So in last 2 to 4 years, a lot of things have changed over time on web. A lot of new techniques have come, which have helped us move away from just Wordana, Georgia, or Lucida. And all of these techniques are rampant and used very well. Hasgeek also uses on their site, right? I think they use TypeKit, right? Okay, and Google. So I think he gets pretty good number of hits, but it doesn't take a hit on his server load or optimization to a decent extent. So that trade-off is still good. A lot of people a lot of clients come and say, okay, let's not use external fonts, or let's not use font foundries, because there will be a lag, the server will take a hit and things like that. But if you really want to bring out the design, you can actually go ahead and use it. You have CDN servers, you have servers from Google who are supplying you fonts. There will be a slight lag, but they take your whole design to the next level. Things like Type Tester, can actually help you check the fonts even before you are entering them or using them in your design. Just go and you have these Lorem Ipsum or the quick functions over the lazy dog kind of text, define the entire properties for it, compare the different fonts, see what works for you, and then choose. Right? So immediately you get to compare. You don't have to do F5, Dreamweaver, and do that. Right? You get to see all the fonts and test it right there. things like FitText jQuery plugin helps you scale down or scale up or basically use the heading creatively across different mediums. The way you design responsive design your entire page, you have responsive design for your fonts nowadays. Obviously these techniques are new, not completely developed. For example, this cannot be used in your body. He says you cannot use it for your body font. It will not scale up and scale down accordingly, or you cannot guarantee 100%. But for headings, he says, you know, use it, it will work perfectly. So there are all these techniques and new ways of using type across the web and mobile. Type has love affairs with prints and they stick onto them. And so should you. Some examples, this site completely done only on type. No images used whatsoever. Beautiful, right? It doesn't need anything. It's very rare, especially designers in India don't give importance to type or don't use type as their design weapon, which, in my opinion, we can do much better, right? We can do brilliant sites much more than this. Obviously, there are a few exceptions who really do it well, but in large as a community, we need to adapt this. So if you look at this, it's completely done in type. The heading, the main text, if you roll over, the text goes up, things like that. Just go and check this thing. Then there are these grid systems, which allow you to just, you know, make a template for your application, WordPress, or any other web app or website that you're building. Use the grid systems. 80% of your headings are taken there. They're not reinventing the wheel. Very, very brilliant. This was a conference site. Very interestingly, people have this notion that serif fonts are not supposed to be used that rampant. Serif fonts are basically the Georgias and the ones which have these in the end, strokes in the end. Those are the fonts that are called serif fonts. Notice how well it is used even in the body, right? Earlier I said we use in our design only in the headings, but even in the body they've used it very creatively. Again, completely type-based site. So there are like few examples, brilliant examples out there. Use them, study them, go to the next level. So fonts say we like to travel a lot. Browser, mobile, poster, truck, watch, they're everywhere, right? So if you go to these new media, Flipboard, a simple app on iPad which allows you to consume content. Again, beautifully done type. Completely done. The design is based on type. So if you see the grid, the layouts, very, very well done. The next stuff from Microsoft, Metro UI, their typography is brilliant. Windows Mobile, anybody who's used Windows Mobile here? I think everybody will agree, right? Their type has been brilliant. So they've used that as their design weapon in this. They've come back strongly from the previous experiences, right? Vista was bad, then they did something in Windows 7, and then they really took to the next level. So the entire design is tiles and using clean types, right? So if you notice the entire font foundry, they're like very clean, very elegant, to the point, do the task, get out. It's very soothing, you know, it's there. You don't have to worry about it. Then you have apps like CNET News, which uses your regular fonts, but yet it's very, very well done. It doesn't look like a very boring app or a not well done app. Obviously, next generation can do a lot of cool stuff, CSS3 and table grids and stuff like that. Pathetic looking table can become a decent looking clean table like this, right? With just type, with just pure type. So these are very basic things that we need to look at, we need to use them in our day-to-day implementations. Obviously you have CSS tricks, you have the letter pressing effect, you have the shadow effect, you have background stuff that can change. There are a lot more CSS3 stuff that have been on the rise last 1 or 2 years. But again, based on different browsers, different support structures, you need to decide what to use for your project. But you can do stuff like, you know, almost creating a project like this, a poster like this, sorry. It's too bright, but it it says all human beings free, but it's like first time when you look at it, if you're a designer, you will feel it's done on Illustrator or it's not just font, it's just not type, but it's completely rendered on CSS3. I just give a simple example of one more simple unstyled paragraph, how it can be converted. How many of you guys know CSS here? Okay, so I can be fast with this. There is some bit of CSS next. So if you notice, right, this is the heading, an article by someone, and the main, and then there is created by. So simple CSS, like, you know, just to define the heading, you have letter spacing, change the color, add some shadow to it, then you create a span so that the second line, we can apply some styling to it, create a class called meta, define the stuff, letter spacing, border bottom, again one more meta span which will take care of the second one, defining a paragraph style overall. Here we are splitting the column into two, so the main text, if it is there in a paragraph, will split into two. Again, it's not going to be supported by all browsers, but I'm just showing you a technique which is like, I mean, amazing. You can do so much with CSS3. So this defines the column gap. What is the gap between two columns? The line height and color again. Some more stuff. This is again a very interesting key thing. P colon first child, the first line of the, the first column is defined and the first line is made bold. So we are going to see that done completely using CSS. Now we have not modified the earlier stuff. This paragraph we have not touched this. We only defined the CSS and this was the outcome. So if you notice, it's completely transformed. It was split into two columns. This was made italics. This was given bold. This was span once. This is the span two that we talked about. So this is, you know, this whole new level of beauty added to it. And it's much more pleasing. And we didn't do anything much in terms of actual design. You know, open up Photoshop and do stuff. So this was completely done using simple CSS techniques. So things like this are very easy, very simple. We should use more of these often. Just a recap, we saw the basic rules, size, type, context, weight, reset everything. If you're working with browsers, margin, padding, cell spacing, make everything zero before you start. Define your font families. A lot of sites don't do that. Have a fallback font family, first, second, third, fourth. Use high contrast. Readability is bad. A lot of times people use white on blue, white on an yellow background. You can't just read, you need to have a high contrast. Use typography grid, see if you can use responsive type as well. Lot of people say app web design is 80% type. Obviously it doesn't hold true for all the apps. Angry Birds is nowhere close, so I won't stick to that. But, you know, great guys like IA, informationarchitecture.gp, these are one of the great guys on type, the way they use it. Their entire site or their entire, the kind of projects they do are very, very focused on type, including their site, right? So just wanted to show you this example. Some great tools, created only to help you type better, type much more content in a very elegant way. Stuff like Stipy. Stipy, S-T-Y-P-I. It's an iPad app. It's a simple application. So that's what it says. Great design needs us. Treat them well and they will treat you well back. Your friendly font. Some credits and the resources. And thank you for not sleeping. Another small announcement, we are doing a UX conference in June. So if you guys are interested to participate, sponsor, or just, you can take the coffee. Yeah, we'll see what we can do about it. We are working. But I thought just I'll announce that as well. We are also hiring, collaborating, and ideating.
Are there open proposals? Or do you think
We've got few people from UK who are coming down, but we want to have more speakers. So we'll see what we can do. Any questions?
How should we see time and color? Should we treat them differently and then come to a conclusion?
No, definitely not. I personally, like I showed you the example there, right? Couple of examples.
Right.
You can use color and type together.
Right. Right? I understand, but from the point of view of emotions that they convey, how does color alter the emotion of the type and how does
so paint color will, I mean, if I use, say, a bold font with red, right, it's going to give you a different emotion. And I use any other font with red, it will still give me a little bit of danger or that kind of emotion, right? So you can't like really separate them out. But on the other hand, you can use type with just monochrome and still get some sort of effect. But you can't do the other way around, wherein you use just color and try to do away with the types of emotion. For example, a bold type and you give a very pale color, not necessarily it will give that kind of a pale feeling. It may give you a bold feeling because the type is bold, right? So it's a, yeah, you need to use it together, in my opinion. Any other questions?
Are there any people that have done research or some kind of experiments in terms of like how?
I think there are good, I mean, couple of typography guys. I think Fedra, there was an Indian guy who actually converted the entire thing to Devanagari script. So you should look up, it's a really well. Yeah.
You said recent, what's your take on all this?
Pardon me?
You said recent MMP.
Yeah.
What is your opinion on this?
On common? On normalize. Okay. So Prajeshwar is asking what's the take on normalize versus resetting everything? But I mean that's again the basic CSS, right? So it does your job what normal you would do for resets. Wherein you are making your padding, paragraph, body height, line height, type height, standard. So that if you have missed out defining any particular stuff, it's not, I mean you have not left it out. Okay, okay. When I meant reset everything, it's not the reset.css that I'm talking about. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, that's the confusion. Yeah, so that's not what I meant. Reset in the sense of actually resetting everything. Okay, actually defining, yeah, not the reset.css or normalize.css kind of thing. I'm just telling reset everything. Make sure the paragraph is defined. Make sure everything is defined. Even if it means 00 or Times New Roman or whatever, don't leave anything undefined because it will cascade, right? Then the execution part of it, as you said, could be normalized, could be reset, could be any library that you use with. Could even be a custom CSS that you use in your projects over and over. Yeah. Okay, thank you guys, it was nice.